Institute of Chartered Accountants of India, and he's a Chief Financial Officer at BMC Drive Solutions. And for nearly two decades now, he has been working in the realm of audit, risk management, enterprise risk management, process improvements, and helping businesses scale up. Sridhar here is a very dear friend and old client of ours. He has been with the Future Group for some time. He was one of the youngest entrepreneurs in the Future Group ecosystem, and he took the brand to great heights in a very short span of 4 years. And now he has moved on to Procall, which is a digital procurement platform. And I hope he tells us all about what this is in our session today. I also have Shekhar here. I think Sumit seems to have dropped off.
Yeah, Sumit has dropped off.
Okay, let me see if I can get him back on.
His name is showing in attendees. He is not on the stage.
Yes. Yes, he's back on. Okay. So, Shekhar is the managing director of Creepy Solutions, and he has helped many national and MNC food companies to scale up their manufacturing facilities. And over the last 15 years, Creepy Group has worked with clients to identify the right type of project, the right type of technology, how to access this technology. They have a complete project management team on board to help you execute the whole plan.
Cement for taxation, like there was this LBT in Pune, Mumbai, we used to call Jakat, Octra, whatever, to safeguard the local businesses so that, you know, they can promote. But then after GST, when the taxation was streamlined, it was purely efficiency and cost. Those are the factors that played out. So I feel there is an advantage. We have to see how it, you know, evolves in next few weeks and month. But it's an interesting concept, but there's still a time to really see in real business yet.
So there are two parts of this local vocal situation. One are they are you know, requesting buyers to buy local, but in terms of supply chain, where industries are trying to supply the best ingredients from the best place around to give the product that is, of course, the best in its composition. Will that impact the supply chain and the procurement at the general line there?
Yes. See, if you see from an industry point of view, one of the main determinant or variable for decision making was cost. So whosoever was the lowest cost producer got the order, of course, along with the quality. Some of the innovations were there, like if you see packaging, etc. But over the period of time, it got to people who could produce it at a lowest cost. And that is going to play a role even, you know, post-COVID-19. So that's going to be a key factor. Of course, some of the large companies, what they are thinking, what if they are dependent on one destination, their factory at only one place. Now they are thinking that probably they need to think and de-risk and probably have in two or three more states. So those kind of discussions are started happening.
Sridhar, at Desi Atta, you were whole and soul handling procurement for them. What are your views on this local vocal sourcing study?
Before we get into the question, Vishali, so this is the first of an experience for me. I'm very happy to share this virtual stage with senior members from the industry, including you. It's one of an experience, so really thank you for that. Moving to your question, I would completely agree with what Sumit has just mentioned, that, you know, it's, I think, reinvented Make in India. So the only difference that I could make out was that while Make in India appealed more to the industrialist to manufacture in India, Vocal for Local would probably more of an appeal to the end consumer to purchase an Indian product. Like if I could see it, I think that's one of the biggest differentiation that I could see. This COVID-19 scenario has entirely exposed the dependency on China throughout the world. I was just reading a statistic which mentioned that, you know, that US may have access to technology in pharmaceuticals, but 80% of their APIs come from China. That averages about 65 to 70% in India. And the, another fact is that not just companies, but there are countries that are dependent on China for their manufacturing needs. And that's why I think Atmanirbhar Banna and Vocal for Local is, it's a great time to come up with that. Our own honorable PM had stirred the pot of thought that, you know, he is a great marketer and he came up with his usual charisma in his usual manner. I would like to draw a parallel fall on instruction. When it's really keeps fighting it, keeps incentives to the industries in a manner so that they grow, otherwise it will just die out. Even this call of Vocal for Local will have the ability to do the, do just that. Individuals, competitors in the space of Make in India, it shall subside eventually. I would not be commenting upon the procurement part of the Asiata company because when I was associated with Future Group, the dynamics were entirely different. Now the situations are completely different, haven't really procured in some time, so I don't know the harsh reality of what's happening on the ground. But if the government does not keep backing it, keep patting it again and again, this Vocal for Local might die. I must also add that during this lockdown and COVID-19, it is the local vendors, products and services that has helped us survive. I eat a lot of chips and Lay's was not the first thing that was available. I would eat Balaji wafers and now I'm completely hooked on to them. So definitely this coronavirus has taught us the importance of local manufacturing, market and supply chain, and our Prime Minister is probably propagating that fact only.
So do you foresee a lot of impetus in policies which might help this movement?
I hope that it happens. I genuinely hope that it happens. You know that we were an agrarian economy and we suddenly shifted from an agrarian economy to a service economy. Industrialization never happened properly in our country. We were having the conversation the other day about a new product and then we have to import products from China. While I completely understand that we should be self-reliant, but that didn't happen. If government takes it right, I think people have the enthusiasm and the will to make it happen in India. I just hope that it happens, yeah.
The sentiment is right.
Yeah.
So, moving on to Shekhar. Shekhar, the production systems now, Sridhar has spoken so much about our dependency on China. How will the production system change in this post-COVID, this new sentiment of how do you foresee that happening? What do you predict the impact is?
Basically, can you hear me? Can
yes.
All of you? Okay, fine. Hello, all of you. I will just extend to what Sumit and Sridhar has spoken. But there is one more angle since I am more in a production side for almost 2 to 3 decades. What I see that to make Vocal for Local, the efficiencies, standards of the product, these are very critical things that we'll have to actually work upon and where people can vouch on our services, our delivery specifications of the products. So this is the area where if I link it back to the production, so as the entrepreneur, I will definitely think on the ways and means how I can improve on the overall consistency of my production, overall consistency in the qualities of the product. Secondly, because of this COVID-19, we have come up with different challenges as what Sumit was mentioning about the skilled laborer migration and all that. So automation will play a very vital role in coming times, means even for the simpler operations. Food industry, particularly in the packaging department, there is a lot of manpower involved. And there are very simpler steps which can get converted into a small automation. So on one side, there is a great opportunity for startups who can really work on small automations, services which they can provide to the industry and thereby bring some disruption that can improve the efficiencies, that can improve the productivity, even it can reduce the cost. So automation is one area where we have to work upon. Efficiencies, productivity is another area. If I really want to watch on my product and I want to present it at a global level, so I am manufacturing it at a local level, but it has to be to the standard of globe. And I will not deny and shy to say that when we are working in project management activities, the most of the preference, at least for family-owned organization, is Chinese equipments, and it's just because of cost. And it becomes too difficult to match that cost if somebody wants to develop in India. So there is a lot of work need to be done, and we cannot expect everything should come from government. We as an entrepreneur, we should actually do some exercise, efforts, and make ourselves more efficient.
Shekhar, you've touched upon a very important topic of cost, because Sumit also said procurement is dependent on how cost and efficiency and quality come together. What would be your advice to the startups or the companies who are right now trying to sustain, as to be able to compete with the market on cost? What can they do broadly, if there are some key points that you could mention?
Yeah. Fortunately, I have worked with one startup. Means I am co-founder for one startup. Almost for 4 years, I am working upon it. Startup. If you ask me, the definition of startup is anything which is innovative, which is scalable and disruptive, can be rated as a startup. Even when I am analyzing startup as a category, there are two different ways to look at startup. One is definitely how we can make it what we say is MVP, minimal viable product or project. And second, of course, the more area of interest is always that stage funding, stage one funding, stage two funding. I think the startup owners, they actually should work on the product more than and make it work out on the viability of the product or the app, whatever they are developing, rather than working that how they will get funded. Because surprisingly, whether it is a big or small startup, I have not seen any major startup making a huge money. They are burning money, they are burning the cash. Some more efforts need to be taken by startups. And it's not necessary that we should have any complex solutions. There are simpler solutions. People should work upon simpler solutions and work on those simpler solutions. You can get fantastic returns. So, of course, it is not a startup, but then also I would like to cite one example. You must be aware of that Mythical fridge, which doesn't require any electricity. It is designed with, it is an earthen pot basically. And yes, so this kind of requirements are there. And if we work upon those kind of requirements, that can bring value.
And Sumit, you've been working in the field of finance and shared economy and everything. Where do you think this whole startup, where do you think people are going to put their money on now as they go forward? Is there some broad idea in place?
You know, what this COVID-19, everybody, I mean, whomsoever we talk in the startup community, everyone was like week after week, you know, things are just changing, and every fortnight just getting extended. So it's so fresh. And if you see, a lot of big businesses are busy right now in, you know, raising more funds, in, you know, strengthening their capital. I mean, if you take example of Reliance, if you take some of the examples of banks and also telecom, and a lot of such companies who are high in debt, or everybody wants to strengthen their capital base. So I think the startups will also go in the similar fashion. I mean, we see Ola, there was a news today or yesterday that they are raising funds. Everybody would want to raise funds to strengthen their capital base. And I think even from the venture capitalist point of view, right now, I think they would be wanting to support their existing bets. The reason is this situation is so much unheard or so much unexperienced by anyone, and everything came to the standstill. And I think nobody thought the after effects as we see today. And I think it's going to be really worse next few months until the things really comes back on the shape. And therefore, like so many restaurants, or so many new businesses, new entrepreneur businesses, they are just not working. Like home delivery, e-commerce, which was largely the startup kind of, sector. So we really have to see how this pan out. It's too early to say, you know, where it will go, to be very honest for me. But I think most of the startups and the venture capitalists would like to make sure that their existing businesses are well funded.
Fair enough. Sridhar, you have made a move from a big company to a startup. And what is the difference? Both of them are food in the food space. Is there some stark difference that you're looking at in terms of processes or in terms of working methodologies that you would want to share?
So, of course, there's a lot of difference in how we used to work in a big corporate and how we work in a startup. Things are pretty well defined when you're working in a corporate. There's a team, there's a structure. When it comes to a startup, I might have a designation of the director, but there have been days when I'm redesigning the presentations and reworking the PDF files, merging them. And I'm not saying that it's something that I wouldn't do, but there's no structure. You're supposed to manage your own clients. You're supposed to, in a startup, you're basically supposed to do everything. Right now, just like Sumit Sir was saying about the startups, honestly, for us, it has been a great time. I'm not saying that we are being opportunistic, but we try to bring efficiency in procurement system for large enterprises, trying to digitize their trades. And it has been good for us because companies are right now probably looking for consolidation, trying to bring their jigsaw puzzles together, and we're helping them do that. So they have been really hectic last 4 months for us in that matter.
Sridhar, you just directed me right into the next question that I have for you. In this whole distancing and not actually going and meeting and not having lots of gatherings, how do you see procurement will change? What does your product do to kind of help in this COVID situation? It's suddenly very relevant, right?
Irrespective of COVID or not, our product is still doing the same thing. Pre-COVID and post-COVID, the pitch does not have changed. In fact, we've got two models. One is the marketplace model and one is the enterprise model. Agriculture in India is about a $265 billion industry, and it's one of the most unorganized sectors, as far as I know, as per my understanding. There have been a lot of players who have, you know, come and tried to organize it. The big players who had come in to organize this sector were players from the West, and they didn't really understand the subtleties and nuances of how we do business in India. At Procall, our vision is completely to digitize the entire agri trade, and we started with enterprises. If you see what are the biggest challenges that an enterprise would face while they're making procurement. Procurement in a way is, I think, a thankless department. No matter what prices you get for a company, somebody will always be there who can say that, oh, main se aur better price la sakta tha. This is how it usually pans out. What we're trying to do is we're trying to help the purchase department with the demands, identifying vendors, bid preparations, rewards, contract management, purchase requisitions, purchase order, goods and services, invoicing, payments, bringing their entire source to pay journey to one platform so that the things that are really scattered for them, which takes a lot of man hours, we just consolidate for them and help them grow their business to bring in more efficiency. And with more efficiency, it definitely helps in cost saving. And I don't think there is even one company in world right now that's not thinking of cost saving. So right place at the right time, that is helping us.
Great, good to know that. And how can startups use that right now? Do you have something that the people who are really looking for efficiency, how can they access your service?
I'll break it into two parts. Startups, the only way startups in a way are helpful is because they're more agile. It took us literally 3 to 4 days to adopt working from home. We just had to set up processes that, okay, listen, 10 to 12, we all will be available on our video calls. We're all there. For bigger organizations, that stuff. So adoption of this new working style was really easy for us. I'm not saying that we didn't have our times where, you know, we had mental fatigue, too much work, but it really helped at a human level. Of course, everybody's facing challenges. I'm sorry, I forgot the second question. Could you please repeat?
I said, will it be easier for startups to kind of service for food startups to look at?
It is. We just have our prerequisite the criteria before we onboard a client. If that matches, we help. And still, we just pick up the calls, probably connect with the clients on LinkedIn, ask them if you need our service, pick up the calls, talk to them, tell them about the product. So that has not really changed for us in pre-COVID and post-COVID as well. In the marketplace model, of course, where we have our partners working in mandis, it has helped because now our pitch has changed to rather than, you know, communicating with each other over in person, when you're dealing in mandis, now you can just do it over our platform. So that is one part that is really picking up.
So, Sumit, interestingly, Sridhar is talking about a different way of procurement. Are there any more alternative models that procurement you'll see in procurement that will happen?
You know, I'm seeing some very different trend on B2C, if I say so. B2B is, we'll see, but B2C, suddenly there is this, you know, aggregators of farmers, you know, who have come up and they have started delivering to urban societies, you know, either it is through WhatsApp or either through it's some very simple proof of concept of the mobile applications. And maybe it's thanks to COVID, but it is helping them to improve their margins. I hope so. But it started largely with some of the fruits and mangoes and vegetables and all. And I think if they give a good supply, you know, it will increase. What has happened is because in urban also, because of the increased urbanization, there are a lot of people staying in the same society. And for a farmer community, it is possible to supply fresh vegetables and fruits especially. So that change I have seen. Which earlier was not happening, but right now at least they are, you know, in bulk, like hundreds of dozens of, you know, mangoes and coconuts and so many things. I get to see that. With respect to grocery, it was always there. Some of the players like Big Basket and Grofers have initiated this, but grocery margin is very different. So we don't know, you know, what will it really turn out. For B2B, I think there were always, you know, like share economy platform, and some other platform, there were always businesses who wanted to get into this category. I think their businesses will increase. You know, they will start seeing the more as a share because everybody has realized that without going to internet, now the business cannot work. Like, for example, how we are conducting this event on Townscript. Earlier, probably people would go to a seminar and have this. Similarly, a lot of things are happening on education. So similar things will, people will realize that it has to be there on the platform. So I think a platform which like Shekhar has created, like Share Economy, now people will realize that it must be, I mean, the business must be there on those platforms.
Wonderful. Shekhar, coming to you, what trends do you see? Where is the food industry heading or where is the new investment? Is it going to be on technology? Is it going to be on new product development? What is your vision on that?
Of course, the beauty of the food business is it was always stable and it is always stable. So we have never seen any peaks in food industry as a segment. If there is a growth of 10-12%, gradually year and year we are working in similar percentage. So it is not much varying. Any opportunity, any problem gives an opportunity for sure. So if you look at if I relate it only to COVID, there will be lot of opportunities for small startups or food industries who will working on the immunity based products. They can work on the health based products. Likewise, as Sridhar mentioned and Sumit mentioned, that the logistics communicate to the customer, there will be big opportunities to the startups because things are not going to remain same at least for next 8-10 months. We can come to the normalcy after that, but till that time, if somebody are able to establish some kind of robust system to deliver the products to the door. Tension even the farmers have taken a great initiative. Side related to developing some apps or some kind of using AIs for delivering of the products or procuring of the products and product development in terms of simpler products. meeting to the requirements of the customer. Secondly, if you look at the country as a whole sector and unorganized sector, particularly in food industry. So, you can see a lot of unorganized brands also making a sizable, very reasonably good business. So, and every region has some kind of specialty in terms of food products. So, this can be a great opportunity to identify something, quickly turn around and bring it to the market. So, that is what I can say.
Shikhar, Sumit mentioned something about share economy. Can any of you put a little more light on that? What does that mean? Where does this go?
Okay, so I hope it will be helpful to the people who are actually attending this. Since I have spent more than 25 years in the food industry, I realize that every company has a spare capacity, and that underutilized capacity is a major challenge and pain, not only to the owner, business owner, but also to the employees and the overall ecosystem. And such a huge investment made by any individual, and he keeps struggling. And then a new entrepreneur, a new startup, they approach it and they want to establish something new. So there is again a financial investment, capital investment. So what we thought another, and utilize this untapped potential spare capacities. Not to market my product or not to market my organization or startup, but it's proud to say that only in 5 districts we have been able to identify more than 5,000 plus companies who are having spare capacities. It is only in 5 districts. And if you look at the database, if the total MSMEs in our countries are more than 3 crores plus, and everybody has this spare capacity available with him, except the multinationals. So that kind of potential is there, and this will be beneficial for anyone who wish to come into new business. He can avoid his capital investment. He can immediately get his product started. He can test market it with smallest of the investment. So this is what I think, if the even 1% of people get benefit of it, I think we have served the purpose.
So while you're talking about consolidating the manufacturing capacity, do you see this kind of trend where people get together and do collective sharing of resources, even in other processes through the food manufacturing, maybe raw material, maybe a distribution? Is there any hope of that happening?
Of course. So basically, anything, means, for example, I think there is app, truckbada.com or something like that. So what he is doing is actually doing same thing. He is ensuring the total truckload from particular region. And now if I want to send some stuff to Punjab from Pune, the overall cost is 80,000 and I have to send only 5 tons. And if I go to this truck bada, if I can arrange, I can literally send it in 20,000. So such kind of any products or any concepts will definitely work. We are also working on a product development activities. So everybody don't have their own R&D centers. So if somebody comes and approaches to us, and if we can reduce that time, turnaround time, if we can help them in developing new products, that can certainly helpful. Even the product what Sridhar is working upon, I think that can contribute a lot. So it is more how you use the available resources which are already developed by people, and make a more efficient way of managing your business.
Yes. Shikhar, it looks like it's time to come together rather than work individually in silos. So while people have gone home and are working at home, it's time to come back together and work as a team, whether you're a competing brand or whether you're a startup or a big company. So it's an interesting way that things are moving. I would like to open the stage for questions from the attendees. If there are any questions that somebody wants to ask, maybe we can have them.
Yeah, please.
Guys, you can just... A very interesting question by Vanshika Agarwal. She has asked whether the marriage sector and the food sector, is it correlated, and with lesser gatherings happening, will that impact the food industry? Is anybody wanting to take, Sumit, would you want to take that up?
Yeah, I mean, you know, Horeca is such a big segment, which we call hotel, restaurant and gatherers. None of the food brand is ignoring this segment. Because for the sheer reason that the consumption is so high there, you know, like if you go in the hotels, restaurant and catering season, the entire marriage season has gone. And of course, there's a big impact and hit, especially because this is also summer, and the summer was the heavy season for these functions. So definitely there is impact on the food businesses.
What would be your advice for Horeca? Is there something they can do? Any innovation they can come up with?
So what Horeca, interesting thing that you're seeing, some of the fine dining restaurants and all are coming with the concept that people can make food at home similar to what they get in an innovative way. Let's see how it picks up, but this is one thing that I have seen people are working on, where, you know, people can get some good experience or eating different food from their favorite restaurants or brands. In fact, the Rebel Foods have also extended their platform where, you know, small entrepreneurs, if they have some concept around it, can launch their product to their platform, cater to the similar needs.
Interesting. Hope that answers your question, Vanshika. I have a question. We have a lot of students attending this webinar. So we have some students from Allahabad Food Technology College, and we have some students from Khalsa College. So there is an interesting question from Raj Robik, sessions now, and the markets are so volatile that there is hardly any hiring happening on that front, not just for the food sector, but for overall all sector. What would be your advice? What are the opportunities for the freshers who are just graduating? What's your advice for them? I think everybody can just chip in and give one answer. Sridhar, do you want to go for that?
There have been a lot of companies who have revoked their job offers. And of course, it creates a panic. In fact, a dear friend had started a website to counsel students who are not what will happen to their lives. But probably this is going to be the new normal. Till the time there's a vaccine or there is a certain solution, I don't think that things will go back to the normal that we had 6 to 7 months back. Will exist, the jobs will come up, but it's just that the industry is trying to figure out how do we absorb more people, because the businesses are changing entirely. Like for example, I was just speaking to one of the largest hotels. Tourism is not happening anymore. They were worried that people will not come to restaurants. So similarly, all the other sectors are also worried as to how to get to the longer coming in. That's all I can pitch in.
Shekhar, do you have something to add to that?
I know more about the food industry related small example of my own organization. It is more than 2 months, everything was standstill. But recently, for last 1 week, we are flooded with lot of the, we find out better ways and means to address the issues. Atmanirbhar hum pehle se hi hai, aur that is the beauty of we all of us. And I think this will get overcome. There will be, we'll definitely find out ways. My suggestion to the freshers is take this as an opportunity and look for some innovative ideas. Go for your own, and you can make a difference. You can make a difference for yourself and to the world.
Sumit, anything else you
would want
to add to that?
No, it's a very valid point. Shekhar has said, even I've seen some of my clients who started their business immediately on May 4th and 5th. You know, it was initially very small, but they see they're already at a 50%, 40 to 50% of the business, what they were doing before COVID-19 month on month. So, of course, it's not back to the normal because they've lost business for a few weeks, entire April. And I think, I really hope that in 2 to 3 months, it should be back to normal. And, you know, we all Indians should probably forget and feel that, okay, COVID-19 was something like an history. That's I'm really hoping for.
Bad dream. I have a very consumer driven question which even I want an answer for. Naina is asking whether the people will be ready to eat food outside after COVID. Where does the ready to eat or ready to consume food market lie? Do you see that it will be affected badly or it bounce back soon? Sumit, do you want to take that?
I don't think so it will impact. See, like COVID, but once the industries don't think so, they've impact as what people say are bad. For example, there was an impact on non-vegetarian food when the COVID-19 had just started picking up globally. Maybe that trend for some time we will see, but I don't think so because people also have short memory. And when the things will start.
I have an interesting question from Tanya. Tanya is asking, if we have a global impact on our products, will the global markets, where does that impact lie? Shekhar, do you want to, Sumit, would you want to take that question?
Any economy should protect their own entrepreneurs first. Any country. You should have made a very valid point that we were agrarian economy before and the transition wasn't as smooth for us when we moved to the service industry or say even manufacturing industry. We did not produce the best of the products globally accepted. And also Shekhar has mentioned that it's probably the thought, a lot needs to be done at a process level like automation, efficiency, because people will buy product not just because it's local, it also has to meet quality standards, the price. And once the product is out there with the quality, what consumer wants, I think, first of all, it will have a global acceptance. I don't think so just because Indians will start using more Indian products. I think it's more because we did not produce a good quality products in the past. If you see, I'm forgetting about the food business. If you see, I think there is a big opportunity. So many brand or so many food has come to in India from abroad and have become mainstream food. For example, Maggi is a fantastic and classical example. We never ate Maggi or our forefathers never ate Maggi, but today Maggi has become staple food. And there are so many such examples. And why does that happen? Because globally, these companies are able to give very consistent and quality products. Of course, with the great marketing and branding support. But if we do those similar products, I think that there is a global demand for it, not just the local.
Thank you. Harsh is asking if, Shekhar, you spoke about automation and manufacturing. So there is a manufacturing side of automation, but is there any vending machines in where there is more contactless delivery happening? Is there a scope there?
Definitely it will open an avenue and there will be more possibly contactless. It will also be a convenient way of doing it rather than approaching and getting into the market at the public places. So I would answer in short that yes, there will be a good opportunity to this, but it's not that it will go exponentially high. It will go to one level and that there it will get stabilized, because as I mentioned earlier also, we are used to lot many things, and within 1 year's time nobody will remember COVID-19 back in market.
That's very optimistic by Shekhar, sir.
I wish really that happens.
It will.
I have another question by Vanshika. Vanshika is saying that good sterilization facilities are not accessible to smaller units, whereas big manufacturers have very easy access to sterilization. How to go about that? How can small manufacturers be able to combat the sterilization need now? Shekhar, I think that would be your domain of expertise.
Sorry, I'm just going through her question. This is a very specific question, but I will say that even the autoclave, a small autoclave can work as a sterilizer. So even if you are a small startup, you can use autoclave as a sterilizer and develop the product and market the product. Now I will give you a fantastic example that, as I mentioned to you earlier, that we are also in R&D industry, we have our own small R&D. And once, I don't want to name the company, but one multinational company approached to us and they were looking for some sterilized product. And it was only for test market. We literally supplied almost 10 to 15 tons of material by using a lab autoclave and meeting to their standards. So it is a, one has to look at the ways and means.
Great. And again, another question directed for new Shekhar's domain. Scope for fortifying foods with immunity boosting products. Is there a scope for such kind of product?
I think you are also working. You have to keep up with the trends. Why not?
Yes, I think I have a little piece of information on that. So I feel that immunity is not a new story. People have been working on immunity for way too long, and there are more and more products. It's just that now with post-COVID, maybe it will be easier for people to hop onto the boat and believe the immunity power. But efficacy of these immunity booster products will now be right there for people to see. So product development with the claim need to go quite hand in hand to be able to claim immunity, because gone are the days where people could say that this has a little turmeric, so it is very good for you. Yeah. You really need to be able to justify what you are claiming. So I think that would be the way forward for any product development. People will now start questioning everything.
Immunity booster could probably be the new gluten-free, I guess. They've exposed that a lot, they've abused that a lot. I think it's going to get on every product. In fact, I was just looking at a sanitizer bottle and a soap the other day, and it already has better for your immunity. I don't know how does a soap improves your immunity, but it was there. So it's definitely going to come in.
Yeah, it's the new claim that everybody's going to hop on to, so, with a pinch of salt.
I just add small in this. Turmeric is one of the fantastic ingredients people should work upon, and it can come immediately, building your even supporting to your health.
Yes. The turmeric, because it's this so ingrained in us, right? We think of immunity, and the first thing that comes to our mind is turmeric. So it's beautiful. Yes. While the world takes a sip of turmeric latte, I think it's high time India wakes up to turmeric and starts using it.
Just to add one small point to it. Sorry, I was in South Korea, and there they have created the, you know, if we come out with some products, and they had made the small, sachets. People can cut it, people can keep it while they are traveling, or can have those nice version of those products. I'm sure people would want to have.
Yes, we should start owning the space. Sakina is asking that there are lots of home cooking happening now, and people are almost getting used to cooking at home. Will that affect the packaged food industry and the ready meal food industry?
I think Shekhar can answer that.
So if I will just give an example of my own home. So I am trying all the new recipes. So my eating has increased. Not only of my entire family, we are eating a lot. So I don't think that will impact. Both will go together.
In fact, sure. I don't know how is it going at a scale, but there was a shift in my house when a key and ground our wheat and then get the flour. But right now we are buying packaged, so I think we have moved more towards packaged foods. I'm not just ready to eat, but otherwise overall packaged food as well, because there's a trust with the company that okay, this must be better, and there's no contact as such. So probably I think this lockdown has pushed a little more towards increase in consumption of packaged food.
So interestingly, while immunity claims are taking the front row seats, hygiene claims also come up, where people are talking about contactless packaging, automation, and their facilities. Yes, Prateek, I think we have one more question. Time for one more question. So I will take Prateek's question in the last situation. One wants to. Can someone highlight how companies are managing their distribution in the current situation, and what changes can we see in the coming months in the food sector with respect to distribution? I think again this might be Shekhar's domain. Shekhar, would you be, or Sridhar? I'm not sure.
I think I'll be able to add to Shekhar's answer, but would love it if he takes it.
Okay, so we also have a manufacturing plant. I have one spice processing plant, and we are seeing these challenges. So what Pratik has mentioned, definitely there are challenges in supply chain, backward, forward, and but we are overcoming them, and things will get stabilized, they will get streamlined with time, of course, not immediately, at least for next 2-3 months. There are a lot of ways and means. I think there are certain products available or sub technologies available where you can use those technologies and see that you can use those apps. जैसे मैंने ट्रक भाड़ा का बोला, वैसे काफी apps है जिनको use करके you can meet overcome this problem. That is what I can say.
Sridhar, you want to add something to that?
Once this COVID had just kicked in, when there was a complete lockdown that was happening from, I think, 23rd March to 30th March, the first week, by the end of the first week, we were able to gauge that there's going to be a major supply gap. And we worked on this website called essentialcommodities.com. where within our network, we were able to list down somewhere around 20,000 metric tons of supplies, private network itself. I will now jump to, I think, 10th April, 11th April, just 10 days after we had created, we were receiving a lot of responses. But we never saw that there was a huge gap in the supplies as such. What we were anticipating, that never happened. So ground realities, I'm not sure what really happened, but somehow things were getting managed. Shekhar sir just said, hum already Atmanirbhar hain. So no matter what happens, Indians do manage. That's the beauty of our country. But I think that distribution, of course, it needs to be streamlined. The products can't be thrown multiple times like they were did before, from one distribution center to a distributor, to a wholesaler, to a reseller. Of course, there need to be an overhaul in the entire supply system. But I think things will come to its pace. They will eventually come into its pace.
Sumit, any concluding lines on that?
I really feel that, you know, and the reason I'm saying it, it's more emotional statement, because I see a lot of impact on the clients' businesses, and then I always want you know, this situation to go out, you know, that's how I'm coming from. But one thing has happened, that this is also helping people to think different. Right now, a lot of people are busy in their financial management of the business and how they should manage getting the people. But somewhere, if we also think innovative and take learnings from this, it will be good. You know, what different kind of demand can come, you know, what could be the different things. Let's see how it stands out in future.
Fine.
Okay, I think we are at the end of the session, and we also have mostly covered most of the questions. But thank you Shekhar, thank you Sridhar, thank you Sumit for joining us today. I hope it was helpful for the participants. A video recording of this would be available shortly for other people to share and see. We will also be coming up with two new webinars in the same series. Touching upon different topics. Here we spoke about supply chain, production, and investment. We will be talking about safety, hygiene, sustainability, and brand management in the next webinar. So please do watch out and log in for that event as well. Thank you so much, everybody. I think we can.
Shall we think, which are still unanswered. So is it possible to communicate them by one or other way, by emails or something, because people have taken their time, important, valuable time. So I don't want somebody's question go unanswered. So find out
definitely,
a way how we can
reply. Shekhar, I will take a cognizance of all the questions, and we can send out an email or with the small snippets of answers to all the participants.
And thank you very much for arranging this. This was the first time I had tried it, but it was a wonderful experience. And thank you to all participants for being with us.
Thank you. Thank you for everything.
Thank you.
Yeah. Thank you. Bye. 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 Bye.